universal, whether the notes issue from the mouth of God or from that hungry infant. But where do these notes come from? Why do our ears select certain notes and not others? For example, why do children tease one another in a specific sing-song way? Na 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 na. Two very special notes, which children also use to call one another, Jerry, Doris, whatever, and which are often used by them in their singing games. Little Sally Water. Now that's the same two notes, only now expanded to three notes. Little Sally Water. Or perhaps you once yelled, Ollie, Ollie, I'm free. Does that sound familiar? Well, again, we must ask, why just those notes in that particular order? Research seems to indicate that this exact constellation of two notes and its three-note variant is the same all over the world, wherever children tease each other, on every continent and in every culture. In short, we may have here a clear case of a musico-linguistic universal, and one which can be identified and explained in a non-vacuous way. I want to take a little time to do this carefully, because in the explanation lies the key to musical universality in general. The answer to the question, why just those notes, and eventually to the question, why those notes in Mozart, and why those notes in Copland, or in Schoenberg, or whoever. And in having an answer, we musicians have a singular advantage over the linguists, who ask their question, why just those sounds in human speech? And they seek their answers by constructing a very complex hypothesis, which is still very much in the working stage, subject to proof or disproof, amplification or derision. But we musicians are luckier. We have the built-in, preordained universal known as the harmonic series. And to those of you who know all about the harmonic series, I beg your indulgence for a few minutes so that I can sketch it out for those who don't. This acoustical phenomenon called the harmonic series or overtone series is not hard to understand if you remember the basic high school fact that all sounds are produced by vibrating bodies which send out waves. Now, if such a vibrating body is irregularly constituted, like this floor or this piano, it will emit waves which are irregular, and our ears will perceive them as noise. Ow. But if the source of vibration is of a consistent structure, like any one of the strings in this piano, it will emit regular waves, and we hear them as a musical tone. Of course, the source doesn't have to be a string. It can be a column of air, as in a clarinet, or a column of steel, as in a tubular bell, or a stretched animal hide, as in a kettle drum. But whatever it is, it produces what's called energy in vibratory motion. That's the official language. By being beaten, blown, plucked, struck, or frictionized with a bow. Now let's settle for a piano string. Let's say this one, which is of a particular length, tension, thickness, and density, and when struck by its hammer, produces sound waves at a frequency of 132 vibrations per second and is known to the world as the note C. Now comes the interesting part. If I sit at the piano and play that low C, you may think you're hearing only that one tone, a dark, rich bass note, but you're not. You are simultaneously hearing a whole series of higher tones that are sounding at the same time. And these are arranged in an order preordained by nature and ruled by universal physical laws. And if this is news to you, I hope it's good news. Because all these upper notes, of which you may be unaware, result from a phenomenon of nature whereby any sound-producing source, or I should say pitch-producing source, such as this piano string, vibrates not only as the whole string in all its whatever-inch glory, sounding that low C, but also in fractional segments of that string, each vibrating separately. It's as though the string were infinitely divisible into two halves, into three thirds, four quarters, and so on. And the smaller those segments are, the faster they vibrate, producing higher and higher frequencies, and therefore higher and higher tones, overtones, or harmonics, as they're sometimes called. Now, these overtones or harmonics are all sounding together with the fundamental sound of the full string. And this is the basic principle by which the entire harmonic series is generated, starting on any fundamental tone. Now, if you already knew all that from high school physics, you will also know that these overtones are naturally less apparent to the ear than the fundamental, which is in this case low C. And in fact, they sound more and more faintly as they go higher. Now, any note I strike will contain its own series of overtones. But the lower the note I strike, the more abundantly audible will be its harmonic series, which accounts in part for the comparative richness of this low C. Now remember, I spoke of a preordained order in which the overtones appear. Let's see if I can make you actually hear those overtones in that order. The first overtone of the series, according to the laws of physics, has to be exactly an octave higher than the fundamental C we've been hearing. In other words, it's going to be this C, an octave higher. Now, if I silently press down the key of this higher C and hold it so that the string is free to vibrate, and then abruptly strike the fundamental C, an octave lower, what do you hear? You are clearly hearing the first overtone vibrating sympathetically an octave above its fundamental. I hope you heard it, did you? Listen again. Clear as a bell. So obviously this upper C is an integral part of the C an octave below. It's a built-in harmonic sounded by the two halves of that lower string vibrating independently. The next overtone of this preordained order results from that same fundamental string vibrating in three parts. And this one will be the first different overtone. That is the first one you'll hear other than a C. And it's going to be a G, this G. And now let's repeat our experiment. I press this new one down silently, and then again strike the fundamental C. What do we hear now? That G, right? A new tone, again clear as a bell. You want to hear it again? Now we've just reached a very significant point. Have you noticed that the fundamental tone and its first overtone are really the same note, C, but an octave apart? But this new overtone, G, is a fifth away from C. So we now have two different tones, and once they are established in our ears, we are in possession of the key to the whole tonal system, a system based on the concept of tonic and dominant. Tonic and dominant. This C represents the idea of tonic, which has the function of establishing the tonal center of any given key. And the function of the dominant is to aid and abet in the establishment of that tonality through a special relationship it enjoys with the tonic, owing to their proximity in the harmonic series. But more of that later. Right now, on to the next overtone, which is again a C, a fourth higher than the G we just heard. Shall we repeat the experiment? I press it down silently. There it is. You hear it? Do it again. Now the next one is again a new pitch, this time a third higher than its predecessor. Notice that the intervals are getting progressively smaller as we ascend the series. It began with an octave and then a fifth and then a fourth and then now a third. And this new overtone will be this note, E. Listen. It's a bit fainter, but it's there for all to hear. Shall I try it again? hear it way back there? One last time. It's clear. And there you have the first four overtones of the series. The fundamental, plus one, two, three, four. Three of which are different pitches. Those three. Now, it must be obvious to you that these three notes, rearranged in scalar order, constitute what is known as the major triad, which is the very nucleus, the cornerstone of most of the music we hear from day to day, whether it's a symphony or a hymn or a blues. And this triad, with its tonic-dominant relationship, plus the third sandwiched in between, this triad is the foundation of Western tonal music as it is developed over the last three centuries or so, along with the development of our Western culture in general. And let's not make the mistake so many people make of regarding this triad as a basic universal. That's a misapprehension that's far too common, in that it fails to recognize that our Occidental culture is only one of many world cultures, in spite of its current prevalence and worldwide influence, and in spite of the fact that it thinks it's the only important culture. A perfect example of this, in fact, of this misconception, arises with the very next overtone in the series, which is a stranger to Western tonal culture. In fact, this next overtone doesn't even appear on the piano, which means I can't demonstrate it for you as I have all the preceding ones. More exactly stated, it is not to be found on the piano in its natural, pure form as it derives by physical law from that fundamental C string. Let me digress for a moment to tell you why. You see, this piano, like all keyboard instruments, is a tempered instrument, which means simply that its notes have been tempered or tampered with. I don't mean a joke by that. I just mean to clarify the word. So that each one of them, each one of these notes, can serve its function in all 12 keys at once. And this readjustment in tuning became inevitable when music reached its tonal adulthood around 1700, and found that it didn't have to remain in one key from the beginning to the end of a piece, but could modulate from one key to another in the course of it. But the notes deriving naturally from the harmonic series will work in only one key at a time. Do you follow that? One key at a time. That is, what's in tune in one key is likely to be out of tune in another. Would you believe that if this piano were to encompass only natural, untempered tones, this single octave space would have to contain 77 different keys? Well, you can understand that a compromise had to be made somewhere. And that somewhere was the moment in history when the rapid development of tonal harmony coincided with the equally rapid development of keyboard instruments with their fixed, unchangeable tones. And that's how the tempered clavichord came to be, to say nothing of this Baldwin Grand. And that's why I can't play you this next overtone. But actually, if we approach it pianistically in our ascent of the harmonic series, we find it somewhere around here, lying in the crack between this B flat and this A. It's one of those blue notes. Now, that blue note can be construed by the human ear as either the higher version of the note, B flat, or the lower version, A. In either case, it requires a little push up or down to be accommodated on a piano. But whichever way we construe it, it becomes our newest overtone. So we are now equipped with four different overtones, the C, plus the G, plus the E, plus that blue note, that dubious A. Or if we rearrange them in scalar order, C, E, G, and sort of A. And here we hit a real musico-linguistic universal, because now we can understand and explain that famous worldwide teasing chant. Na, 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 ollie, ollie, I'm free. Because all it is a constellation of those first four different overtones, with the tonic omitted, or rather implied. You see, this tonic C, which is the same note as the fundamental C, is heard in the mind's ear, and only the three new overtones are sung. And so these three universal notes are handed to us by nature on a silver platter. But why are they in this different order? Because that's the very order in which they appear in the harmonic series. G, E, and sort of A. And Q, E, D. Now this is a substantive universal, the sort of thing linguists hunger for, but the likes of which are simply not available to them. Indeed, as we ascend further in our harmonic series, more and more fascinating and incontrovertible universals keep appearing. For instance, this next new overtone is this one, that is the next new overtone, is this one, D. And so we now have five different tones to play with, which we again put into scalar order. And presto, a new universal is given us, the five-note or pentatonic scale. Now, because of that dubious last note, the scale can take either of two forms, one culminating in B-flat and the other culminating in A. Now, let's opt for the second of these, the lower one, which is by far the most common of the two. Now, this is humanity's favorite pentatonic scale. And by the way, this is the scale you can find so easily on your own piano by playing only the black notes. In fact, the universality of this scale is so well known that I'm sure you could give me examples of it from all corners of the earth, as from Scotland. Pure pentatonic. Or from China. Or from Africa. And from American Indian cultures, and from East Indian cultures, and from Central and South America, and Australia and Finland, and, well, that's a true musical linguistic universal.